There's one back in the rec room, but I don't have access to that right now.
All right.
Sorry. So Harding just got the okay to go ahead and launch him, so he's got that starting place.
Okay, I'll go ahead and start with the safety minute, and if you can put the slides up.
Yeah, Josh, is this the only thing you'll need? Just this one slideshow? Oh,
yeah.
You need just this one.
Do you want your notes view here?
We tried to get notes view working on this.
Okay, I have a hard copy coming. Okay, sounds good. Do you have a stick mic for me?
Yes, I can.
Turned off?
It's turned off right now, but it should be turned up. If it's turned up too high, let me know and I'll turn it down again.
Good afternoon, I'm Carla Browning. I almost don't need this in here, but we do have a webcast, so this meeting is being webcast. Just a couple of brief announcements. First of all, I wanted to give you a safety tip today. You'll find at the back of the room on each station some of these handy dandy ice scrapers. I used mine this morning. In addition to clearing your windshield, it also has the as opposed to when we have a campus closure due to inclement weather. I'm using this as an umbrella so that we take our umbrella with us and it shines, so we won't have any more inclement weather for the rest of the season. Don't hold me to that. But these are available in the back of the room if you'd like to pick those up. Also, I wanted to let you know that we have the webcast going and we have a class that starts here at 2:15, so we'll try to...
Okay, thank you. I picked on Lily all during the initial tests. To hear your thoughts about moving forward, I'll share sort of the latest information that we have and some of the challenges that we face, one of which is just leafing through this page here. But, you know, stop me this year as a system. The House has supported exactly the same thing, and then the Senate has come in at a 5% reduction at 309 for the fixed cost. I'll get onto that on the next page here a little bit. But the UAF portion, it's things like that, roughly 2.7. So we know even with a flat you get the idea. Various elements come into play there. One thing that I want to hear from you about today is the possibility of a UAF strategic reallocation under the flat. I've proposed $1 million, and under the 5% reduction, I reduced that to $500,000. And what might that be about? That might be where we see potential for either research possibilities or enrollment and so what is the right magnitude of that? That's a conversation for us to have today, and it's in the list of questions that I sent around. This is what I've proposed in the two scenarios. I'll give you an example, since I know we're on the West Ridge. I've already made a commitment for UAF strategic reallocation. We hit that. UAF strategic pathways implementation. Some decisions have already been made by the board that we have to implement here. We're estimating about 2.8 for that under the flat budget. We can make a small reduction, but not much, under the 5%, so about $100K there. So a little bit of wiggle room, but not very much. And then the board's priorities or president's priorities, they've informed us under the flat budget that it would be a $3 million allocation. And the strategic pathways implementation element, that is largely the decision by the board to retain athletic is largely what that's about, so that you understand that. There's no hidden agenda here. So that's what's going on. All right? Operating expenditures. So this is, you know, giving you a sense of where we have room for making reductions and where we don't. So this is a UAF-specific slide. You see that at the top in the header up there. This is UAF. What are our contractual services, a bit bigger equipment budget for obvious reasons to keep up with the changing technology? You know, sort of all of the things that you would think of. Severe reductions in travel over the past few years. You've all felt that in your budgets. So that's a smaller proportion than we would actually like at this time. But this is, you know, a sense of how we spend our budget of $439 million. Pretty quiet. No questions so far. Am I moving too quickly? No. This is a conversation.
Yeah, I'm Terry Langton. I'm from the Office of Grants and Contracts.
Yes.
And since you brought up strategic pathways in your prior slide, thank you. I just wanted to know how you see research administration.
We want to encourage the programs, the academic programs that are growing as well, right? We want to encourage. You know, roughly $20 million is general fund supporting research, right? And how do we do that when we're getting these continuous reductions? And you'll see in a future slide, I'll get to that in a minute, where we can make reductions and where we can't make reductions, because we can't just say, oh, we're not going to pay debt service anymore, right? We can't say, oh, we're not going to give out the scholarships we promised to students last year, right? So there are, you know, limitations on where we can make reductions and where we can't.
There's right? also ways to reallocate assets that we have in the research too. Yeah.
That's right.
You know, we just need to have conversations like that if we want the research to continue at UAF or statewide. You know, I mean, throughout the whole state of Alaska.
Yep.
Because we have awesome opportunities.
So you know, I'll push back a little bit. Should we reduce academic programs to help cover research?
You
get the idea. I mean, those are the kinds of, I mean, that's not the only choice, obviously, right? Can and should we reduce administration? I know that one's going to come up. We've reduced roughly $800,000 in and that's part of the reason for this discussion on what is the right amount to reallocate internally, right? So that's part of why that's a key question, right? And if we do that, where should it go? And research is one of those possibilities, shoring up some areas that are already too thin where we feel weaknesses, right? Trying to help programs that are growing quickly, allow them to continue to grow quickly, right, to increase enrollment, because that has very broad positive effects, right? So again, that's part of this conversation. So I'm going to go up to Abel, and then I'll go over to Lily.
Yeah, we have a question back here. If you're speaking from the audience without the microphone, they won't be able to hear you online unless you speak really loudly, because the only mic is right there in the podium. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
And let me open the floor. So my vice chancellors are here. If you hear me say something that you can expand on or correct me, that's okay. You know, I'm human, so I celebrate my humanity regularly. So.
With the Alaska Statewide High School Science Symposium.
Yep.
We get the best students competing in the symposium with research projects in the STEM field. We received UAF scholarship funds for years in excess of $16,000. And I think we probably recruited half of those students who got those scholarships. It was reduced to 10,000 last year. It's 5,000 this year, and next year it's zero. So how is UAF going to raise its student enrollment by 5% when we're cutting all those tools that we use in the past to recruit students?
We're gonna have to make difficult choices there, Abel. I don't know the details of the one that you just cited clearly, but we certainly have some programs that are growing very quickly and providing those growth opportunities for those programs where we have fully paying students instead of scholarship students is part of that answer. But I agree that, let me say that scholarships is one of the areas clearly on my mind with that internal reallocation. Because to grow enrollment, we have to make some investments like that. So that is one of those. We have five working groups on enrollment working right now. They're supposed to give me what they think for each of those areas, the best bang for the buck, and scholarships is part of that conversation. So I think you and I are in agreement on that one. I think easy elements got cut, and now we need to rethink some of those. And so that is part of the conversation. But I appreciate your input on that specific one. Lily?
So I'm Lily with the Geophysical Institute. And I was wondering, on that previous slide, you had $3 million for the
tuition offset for career and technical education programs, for instance. Okay. With these reduced allocations, they haven't been specific with us as to what those would be for. They would be part of that same collection. So you could look at that collection, and it was presented to the board at their UI Statewide's not been specific with us as to which of those they would keep or which ones they would reduce or by how much for these two scenarios. And these appear to be the only two scenarios for us at this point, given the legislative look. Okay? Anybody else have any inside information on that? Julie or Kari?
No.
Okay. I'm pausing. Looks like we answered the immediate questions. So what is the what's the makeup here of our UAF's 439, right? Doesn't include capital, right? So we're not talking about construction here, for example, or as we've had in the past, we've actually had historically, we had some capital research funding as well. Library, e-journal subscriptions, debt service obligations, facilities maintenance and repair. You start getting the idea on the fixed cost. 193 is 44% restricted federal contracts and auxiliary. So what do we mean by auxiliary, for example? That's housing, the bookstore, dining, wood center. They effectively are self-sustaining operations. Right, where we don't give them money, what they take in is what they use to operate. Right, 6%, 27 million, other commitments, student scholarships, waivers, statewide chargebacks. There's a favorite, right? So what are the statewide chargebacks? We pay a fee effectively to statewide for risk. Okay, not sure what kind of detail I could provide there.
Do you have a slide on that?
A slide on risk?
No,
I do not have a slide. I don't have a separate slide on that. All right. Can we run through the risk? So our risk, self-assurance, computing assessment is part of that. Video conferencing services is part of that. And shared software contracts. So those would be examples of the of the statewide chargebacks in those areas. All right? So Cindy, did you have a further question? She's struggling. I'll give you a minute.
I'm good.
Okay. So the remaining 171 out of 439, 39%, that others. Those are figures given to us generally, or commitments that we've already made that we need to live up to. So much more difficult. This is what pays for the delivery of the academic programs, faculty and staff, the general fund support for research that we need to get that leveraging. You know, we talk about Bob McCoy makes a good point, you know, research is multiplicative, it's not additive, right? We've got to have that seed to write proposals, and then that generates return on investment, right? Okay? Services and administration. You know, I struggled with the correct wording here. Is that critical administration? You know, I don't know. We can talk about that. Targets. Certainly reductions. We've made quite a few reductions. We have a number of program reductions on the table at the moment. Those, as you know, don't generate immediate savings because we have a teach-out requirement. And so I would say over the past 5 years, we have a cycle of program review, and we have pretty well thinned out all of the low enrollment, less efficient programs, and we are, what I would say, we are at meat now, right? We have programs on the table that we would prefer not to give up, just that simple. But we're having to make difficult choices on them. Resources, particularly during these difficult budget times, we have a greater need for consultation in such cases, and yet we're relatively thin there. So that's one area that I'm.
And the president for their strategic plans.
So this is a common question. I asked the same question of UA statewide, what they were doing with their savings. And effectively what they're doing is they're covering their budget reduction, right? In other words, there's no reallocation because the money's gone. You don't have the money anymore, right? So that's the principal answer to your question is it stays at UAF, but you know, we can't reallocate it because it's just helping us deal with the budget reduction. It's just that simple. Okay, where there are within UAF. Okay, Kari? So let's get you a mic there. Yeah.
The one caveat is for the president's pullback. So he did a strategic reallocation last year, and he pulled money back from the campuses. A good chunk of that money then he did redistribute back to the campuses, but with very specific requirements. For instance, he allocated some money to UAF for the bond repayment on the engineering building. So we couldn't use that money to address
for anything
program
else.
Reductions. So we're trying to do a quick assessment, but it looks like the president did push back out to the MAUs, UAF, UAS, and UAF, a good portion of what he had pulled back. It's just that we don't have discretion about how we spend it.
Yeah, it's very specific, so we can't use it for our own highest priorities, right? Even though some of the things he did fund were things important to us, let me make that clear. So those are the challenges. Bob?
I think you just answered my question. Did you give him those priorities, or he decided on his own how you should spend the money without input from you, or how did that work?
We do our best to influence those decisions. That's about the best I can say. In some cases, we're effective in that influence, and others, he has priorities that may differ from ours. So there's some of both there, I would say. Is that fair? Okay.
We have a question here, but I wanted to make an announcement.
Jolted.
I have a question from the previous slide where you show the budget, and you have $439 million UAF operating budget, and then you have $171 million below for the unrestricted, and you point out that that's 39% of our budget. So is it 61% of our budget, the $439 million? Is that 61% of our budget?
Yeah. So that's the stuff that we really can't.
We can't.
That we can't really affect.
And is that one of the reasons why the legislature wants to keep cutting us? Because we're only spending 39% of our budget on the mission of the university, which is the academic programs and research?
It's not as simple as that, Jack, I think. They certainly expect us to pay our debts when we build buildings, right? They certainly expect us to honor scholarship commitments to students. It's disturbing to see those percentages, though, isn't it? Where we have flexibility and where we do not have flexibility. So, Yvonne, maybe get the mic from, yeah.
Just to further clarify, though, in
that's certainly fulfilling our mission. So remember, grants that year was about $102 million, just to give you some perspective, right? Go ahead.
Are there any ways that there are research funds or other kinds of grant funds for this mission of our department, for example? So I was wondering if what has been going on at UAF broadly to look for external funds, not state funds? How are we finding more income from external sources?
$1,000, largely local contributors, just for student scholarships. And so they shouldn't make reduction areas. So you start getting the idea. Now, the other out, of course, and apply for those. And, you know, if you've been looking, thank you for looking. Write some proposals, get the submissions out there. I am concerned about the federal climate there. All of you that have been following that, both educational grants, things like TRIO, the Trump skinny budget currently shows a 30.
We have research that attracts new students, that brings more money from the federal government. So it's just kind of all interrelated.
Yeah. And we have that in a whole variety of areas, right? And so when we have a fast-growing academic program that benefits the residence life operation, it helps the dining operation, it helps the bookstore. That process is still ongoing. I think it's about to end here fairly soon. So you'll see announcements on those most recent ones. There are some program reductions that, units looking at the flat budget where they've already are working with human resources, and I expect there will be some developing as well. I would say the timeline is various depending on where those occur, but we'll see some starting in the next few weeks responding to this, both flat and with the potential of. So decisions on the program reviews, I think will be out, my best guess is roughly next week, something like that. So I think I've answered your question close.
Do the academic programs, yeah, that we have to go before the Board of Regents?
Yes, and so there would be actions, it's a matter of getting them on the agenda.
One of the ones that's in program review, we were told we would get a chance to respond. Has that?
Go ahead.
Deal with this in residence life, that we dedicate, our student employees. And when it comes to thinking about whatever discretionary funds you have to dedicate to at least communicating where the cuts have happened, specifically with reductions in staff.
That transparency on where reductions have been made, right, or are being made. So a follow-on to this, we'll have a conversation about specific suggestions for reductions. that the timing of that, we haven't fixed a date for that, but it'll probably be sometime near the end of April, so that, you know, everyone's still here and we'll share the best information we have at that and what we're thinking about specific reductions for FY18. So I do want that transparency. The effect might deal with that. Thank you. Let's come back here. So, you know, we run through the usual process of program reduction, service reductions, consolidations, smaller there's a shared service model in travel that's being exercised, proposal. We had a conversation with the president today about, next year there's an agreed upon 5% tuition increase. That's fairly conservative. Other states that went through the reductions that we're going through raised tuition at a higher rate. There's pros and cons for us. Other states typically have a lower cost for community college engagement or enrollment. We don't. It's the same tuition for everybody. And so raising the tuition up to the Western average for baccalaureates, we're about 19% below right now, not counting the 5% that's planned. How negatively would that impact the community campus enrollment? Because of that expectation for lower costs there. You get the idea. So those are some of the challenges. How can we support enrollment growth? Scholarships is one of those ideas, providing some growth opportunities for programs that are growing quickly, the same in research. What that's part of that internal UAF reallocation opportunity. But that's very painful when you're going through reductions at the same time, and you all know it, especially if you're not on the receiving end of that reallocation. And so that's the challenge and part of the reason for the conversation today. Get a sense of that scale, get a sense of that, you know, what I had in mind in those areas under the two scenarios. Units to protect from the further cuts. We're trying to, and I would say we're close to being fully staffed. We'll be fairly shortly in Title IX. That's an area clearly that's gotten a lot of attention. We need to continue that. We need to support that. And so I'm not intending any reductions to the Title IX office for sort of obvious reasons, right? Are there other units? You heard me speak about HR already. Pretty thin, right? Reluctant to go there on HR. We have some academic programs in the same area. So what are things that come to mind besides Title IX? So you heard me say that the president's provided some direction with regard to development, right? Because he wants to continue to grow donations to the university. If we're trying to grow enrollment, is this the time to cut the admissions office? Maybe not. You get the idea. So what are those areas that we can and should be looking at? I would welcome your thoughts on that. The other question, right, I brought it up before, reserve for internal reallocation. What's the right amount in difficult times like this? I suggested $1 million under the flat, $500,000 under the 5% reduction. Is that reasonable, unreasonable? You know, difficult choices, right? One-time investments, what are those things that we can do just one time? You heard me say I made one of those already. I agreed to a certain amount of match for research grant. Proposals have been submitted for equipment that require match. Already made that commitment, okay? So for a fixed amount, I didn't make it open-ended, but I did make some choices. So are there other one-time strategic investments that might help in some way? And then what are the vertical reductions or consolidations that should be considered? Right? And I know there are opinions on those. I think that's comes back to the timeline question. We'll interrupt. Abel's got a question. Go ahead, Abel.
Well, I have a little trouble with the terminology. We've gone through about 4 or 5 years of cuts now, most of them across the board. So we're no longer talking about investments. We're talking about plugging holes
yep.
in programs. So it's not really a strategic reinvestment. It's like a strategic plug the hole type thing, right? And I think we're at a point where this university is in a real crisis, because we're losing the critical mass in many programs. Biomedical research, we've lost several faculty members, not replaced. In other research areas. So one middle of the road state university, or are we going to continue to be the research university of the world, right? And I think we're at a real tipping point where, if the Senate gets its way and cuts us another 5%, when are we on a path that will take 10 or 20 years to repair? And I think we're very close.
Yeah. I would say we still have choices, Abel. I discussed this with the president and his staff shortly before this meeting. We still have a lot of choices, right? We can raise tuition significantly. Not we'd have to see how much elasticity there is with the cost and enrollment balance there, right? But that's certainly a choice we can do. We can certainly choose to close locations or certain colleges or schools. There's a lot of choice left, right? They won't be easy choices, but there is a lot of choice left. So have we reached the point where we're willing to make those, I think, is the key question, right? If we end up with the 5-4-3 of the Senate, we'd be forced into those, I believe, right? The flat, maybe we can continue to kind of struggle along. So that's my own take on it. But that's why I'm having this conversation with you as well today. Do you think we're at that point or not? Well, are we at the point with the flat? Because when we're flat, we're continuing to kind of eat ourselves alive because of the fixed cost, right? We all know that. But where is that tipping point? That's part of the conversation, I think, Abel. But there's still a lot of choice left. I hope you see that.
Yeah,
doesn't mean it'll be fun choices.
But it's a choice to diminish us.
Yeah, that's right. But to help that large enough choices would give us an opportunity to reinvest, not just shore up holes, but they would be significant choices, right?
Cindy West from United Academics. And you mentioned the word choice.
Yep.
When, as a university, do you think we'll be at the point where we walk into the legislative body who's passing us all these cuts to present the choices where they see their impact, because we are no longer going to be in one of the extended sites because we have to start cutting them off in order to survive? I have not heard that at the legislative, all of that I've heard, but are we at that point?
My own perception, Cindy, is we're very close to that point. The flat budget makes it very difficult. If we went through a couple of years of flat budget and had to eat the fixed cost increases, we're there. If we take the 5-4-3 that the Senate has proposed, we're definitely there. That's just my own take. So, we've got to show sufficient pain to get the reaction.
Hi, Dana. Brian Barnes.
Hi, Brian.
To me, what makes us distinctive, UAF, in the system is our research and expertise in the STEM disciplines. And that distinction holds nationally and internationally for Arctic research. Our faculty do really well in winning competitive grants from the NSF, NASA,
no
recently
question.
NIH. And those same faculty teach the STEM courses here, and thereby our undergraduates in those majors have the opportunity to experience research firsthand, be authors, and go on themselves and succeed in professional and graduate schools.
Yep.
And I think these cross, I know, I've seen that these cross-the-board cuts have really cut in to these distinctions that make us different from UAA and UAS. And I think another round, if across the board, these kinds of numbers, we will lose that distinction. So I would really urge that we pay attention to this in terms of the potential reallocation or just protecting our STEM majors and our research institutes.
Yeah. So let me, I haven't responded to this yet, but I think I will now. So, Brian, I sincerely appreciate your comment. We are distinguished in that regard. I completely accept that, and I would love to see that continue and grow. I mean, no question about that. So the point that I want to raise is the quote across the board. There's a perception that the cuts have been flat for everybody everywhere. That is not at all the case. I've looked at the data over the past several years. Admin services has taken a much higher proportion of reductions than any academic or research area, for example. And there are other examples like that. So it hasn't been flat across the board. I need to make that clear and that so that everybody understands that. And we have very clear evidence of that, both individual years and cumulative over the last 4 years. And so now, has everybody taken reductions? No question. Everybody has been touched. Last year in particular was such a large reduction that there was no way you were going to get there without touching everybody. I didn't, simply because of teach outs, because of all of the other things that go with it, commitments to scholarships, et cetera, you weren't going to get there without touching everybody. So I just wanted to make that, we often use that phrase across the board, and I think it's important to make it clear. It hasn't been flat across the board for everybody. There have been areas that have taken much larger reductions than others. And in fact, a number of things that have been completely closed. So Yvonne has closed learning centers, for instance, in I think 3 different locations. So there are other things that are going on that have just been absolute, we're not doing that anymore. So, but point well taken, and I agree with you. That is one of our, probably our clearest distinguishing factor.
Hi Dana. Bill Schnabel, Institute of Northern Engineering. With respect to cuts, it seems like we've been going through this process for a while. And for instance, last year, when we were going through Strategic Pathways Phase 1, we looked at athletics. And just from talking to people around, it seemed like, yes, that wouldn't be great. But you know what? A lot of people thought if we were going to reduce something, that would be something we would do.
Yep.
And we kind of floated that. And then Board of Regents says no, essentially.
Yep.
So now we're in the position of, do we need to then look at something else that we think Board of Regents is going to accept, or do we still have an opportunity to push back and say, you know what, actually we do think that's the way to go. Is that an option for us?
I think there was such a public outcry over that one. I think that would be probably wasted effort, just my own perception, Bill. I would say internally to the university, there was more support for making that reduction. But externally, boy, it was. I think we had roughly 300 people speaking to it. It's very rare that we ever get 50 speaking to something. And so I think the pushback was pretty hard, both to the board and to the president on that one. That it would be difficult to. I don't think it would be successful. I'd welcome, Kari or Susan or Yvonne or Gary. Gary might not be the best choice here. But is that your sense?
I think not this year.
Yeah, I think if we continued to take reductions, they might go there. But not this year. I'd agree with that. Because they just pulled it off the table.
So I'm Sina Mahita, Department of Sociology, which is about to be cut, looks like. And Bill, you've identified what I think is the elephant in the room. Are we really going to cut departments like sociology, really important programs, but save expensive sports programs? That at some point, we've got to be the conscience for our community.
So, Sina, let me tell you what I've done in that regard. I've said it to both statewide and I've said it to the Board of Regents, so that, you know, I'm on record on this in multiple locations. But, you know, I told the board specifically, whenever they put a fence up on something, like we're not going to cut athletics, they need to understand that that means we've got to cut in other areas. And they commonly, you know, in some cases, they won't even see where we're making reductions. They'll hear about them later, you know. But the more they build fences for us on those areas, the more difficult it is for us to manage the institution and fulfill our mission. Right, and so that's a continuing conversation and dialogue that I have with them. They've spoken up on some other areas as well, where there's been some public feedback. Oh, you can't cut that area. I say, well, okay. Does that mean I reduce research then, and we start losing that international reputation? Does that mean that I lose another major academic program that has 30 or more majors in it? So those are the things that I'm constantly, you know, giving them feedback on, that when they make choices like that, you know, that fencing us in just narrows where we can make reductions. And you saw how narrow we are already in making reductions, right? 39% effectively is where we can make reductions.
Hi, Dana. It's Mark Goldmeeks with Draw and Wood Center. One quick, I'm sure you'll update us on the chancellor search before the end of the forum. Just curious where that is. And then you mentioned the tuition. You know, you would do a little bit larger percentage to catch up, representing other states that have been through similar cuts that they've increased the tuition. What has been the effect on enrollment? I think we've seen the decline in enrollment. If we can attribute maybe a portion of that to tuition, I don't know.
That's not at all clear. Certainly, engineering and School of Management with the super tuition has not seen decreases in enrollment. So, you know, there's some counter evidence to what you're saying. The principal elements that play in our enrollment are high school graduates. That has been on a declining trend in Alaska and is supposed to slowly start turning around in May of 18 and climb slowly then, and then increase a little bit faster at 2021, if you believe the census data. Okay, so we're in kind of this very shallow U shape, right? And we're right at the bottom of the U right now, okay? So that's part of it. The other part is the unemployment rate. When the unemployment rate is very low, so people can get a job instead of going to college, in Alaska, they often make that choice. And so that correlation is extremely strong. And so because the employment rate has been pretty high, that has hurt us enrollment-wise. So those are the two leading factors. There's some evidence that cost might be impacting, particularly career and technical education, but we don't have it so much in baccalaureate. So that's just, and again, if my vice chancellors have any corrections there, I'd welcome them. But that gives you sort of a sense of what we know about it, Mark.
And just quickly to follow up with athletics, and Gary, I'm curious if you, there's the strategic pathways investment, right, into athletics is directed. And then did I read somewhere that the Senate or House is requesting that athletics, both UA and UAF, are funded equally? That maybe UAA is looking at a team reduction?
So let me make it clear. Effectively, what that reallocation does is it's not adding money to athletics. It's providing its base funding. Okay, so it's not an addition to athletics. Let me make that clear. All right, the intent language, there were two elements, and I don't know if one of those got removed or not, so I'll ask for people that are more on top of this. One was, had no impact on us. It was asking UAA to drop from 13 teams to 10 teams, which is the NCAA minimum, and so that would save UAA some money, right, and potentially the state some money. And then the other one, which was strangely curious is UAF should be funded at the same level, and their budget is about double what ours is. All right, they have 13 teams and we have 10, and so I would say our current athletics budget is not long-term sustainable if we want to have competitive teams. Okay. And so if UAA were forced to come to our budget level, they wouldn't be sustainable at a competitive level either, right? And so somewhere in between is probably the right answer if, as the board has directed, we're going to keep athletics.
It's right after 2:10, so we probably should wrap up here pretty quickly. If you've got a question, raise your hand, and we'll try to get to those.
Hi, I'm Sam from OGCA, and I have a couple things.
Hi, sir.
Does the Board of Regents understand that by not cutting some sporting things and cutting academic programs, that we may be losing a lot of students that would come in for the sports because we now don't have the academic programs that they want to go into? So, in essence, we could be losing a lot of students by not actually doing anything with our athletics. And I like the athletics, so I understand not cutting them. Something that... in the research part, why is statewide negotiating our rate with the state of Alaska, and why has it been at 25% for umpteen years? Because it is something that a lot of our programs look at, our state of Alaska awards that come in, we only get 25% FNA when our negotiated rate is at 50.5. So it's a battle that we have with the state of Alaska. And then also, why has our FNA rate, the allocations for our FNA rate, been looked at in a long time? Because I don't really quite understand why 12% of our FNA goes to statewide if we don't see a benefit from statewide. So is that something that's been looked at?
So you're going to have to... You have a series of questions there. I did not write them down, so you're going to have to remind me. So let me start with the most recent one. Myself and all of our vice chancellors press that 12% every chance we get.
Okay.
And I would say we actually have a friend there now. Vice President White experienced that allocation in his time here at UAF, and he is advocating on our behalf. So that dialogue continues. So we press that one during every budget conversation. And, you know, when statewide says, well, we've reduced this amount of money, we say, well, then your FNA rate should transfer, right? You get the idea. And then, so, well, we're using that to cover our budget reductions, just like we do, okay? So that's how the conversation's going. But we do have a friend there now at the moment advocating on that front. Okay, so negotiating with the state, I can't answer that one.
I don't know the answer to that either. I would say the state's position is they give us 40% of our funding for the university, and therefore they should not have to pay the same administrative rate that the federal government pays us, right? Because the federal government doesn't give us any support for the university. So that's the state's position, which is we are subsidizing the university. We're giving you 40% of your operating funds. I do think, though, as they reduce what they give us in operating funds, it's a time where we could start talking with them again. Well, what should the correct negotiated FNA rate be?
But if they're getting federal funds and they're passing those to us, technically it should be at the federal rate, and it's not because we have that negotiated rate at 25%.
Yep. Was there another question there?
It was just more of a statement about the board and cutting programs, and we could be losing academic students because...
So we do point that out to them, that you know, we often attract students because of the collection of academic programs we have, and you know, they often bring friends or relatives or significant others, whatever it might be, because those programs exist as well. One of them decides to come here, and then the other one sees that they have a related program they're interested in. So all of that makes a difference in our enrollment, right? So yes, we point that out. I'm certainly aware of it. So,
two questions and a little less than 2 minutes.
Jack?
It's me again. So I feel guilty about talking developmental education because I know everyone is being cut to the bone here.
So who's me?
What's that?
You never introduced yourself. You just
Well, you call me Jack. I introduced myself earlier. My name is Julie Meyer, Department Chair of Developmental Education and CRCD Math. My question is, we've lost three faculty in the last few years and not been able to replace any of them, and recently have been told that we need to lose another math faculty and not be able to replace that person. And my esteemed colleague will be retiring in the near future, hopefully not too near, and we won't be able to replace her either. Our classes are full, and I've been told that we need to close wanting to increase enrollment, so that I'm presuming that many of those, maybe the same percent of those people will also need developmental education. So if we're closing, down our capacity for teaching developmental education at the same time we're trying to increase enrollment, that doesn't make sense to me, first of all. So basically, I would say that we are one of those places that we can't take any more cuts. I don't want to be put on a pedestal, but basically we are where it starts. We are at the ground, bringing students in and enabling students to come here. And and to persist, and so we're there where it counts in terms of increasing enrollment, retention, teaching them to be good students, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank you, Jack. I didn't hear a question there, so
we do need to wrap it up.
It's very much like Abel's scholarship question, you know, all interrelated.
The room is booked at 2:15, so we're going to have to wrap it up. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll continue this dialogue probably near the end of April. You see the timeline here as we move forward on some of these choices.
Sorry about the tight squeeze.
Got students coming in, so I didn't want to keep them waiting. Thank you. These mics are still on. Yeah. Oops, you turn that off. Appreciate that.
Out of here? Out of logging out?
Where is it?
To log out of here?
Yeah.
Or where?
I want to get this off of here.
Oh, yeah. So that would be down the bottom of my hand.
I'll smack users. Two?
Yeah.
That is here.
But I'll help however you need.
Okay.